afternoon and welcome to Moments of Hope with yours truly, Pastor Curtis Robert Grant. And to those of you that have come to join along with us in our conference call, God bless you. Zion Hope, hello! And so hope all is well. For those of you that are going to connect with us in the conference call, you can dial 515-606-5380 and then the access code is 636-090. And we are in Exodus chapter 34. And I'm going to start with verse 1, because what you see in the writings of Moses, as Moses in his writings seems to be, I wouldn't say redundant, but it's just the way he writes. He shares with you a thing in 33, which we talked about, God hiding him in the cleft, And then what you actually see in 34 is God actually, it actually coming to pass. Okay, and the principle that Moses shared in his writings is very clever and necessary, because what he wants to submit that is that before there's ever a manifestation of a thing in the physical, there is conversation, blueprint, or a process of thinking that has to happen in the spirit before it actually manifests itself in the physical. All right, and you'll find that apply to everything we have to go through, everything we deal with, everything that is manifested in this world. You cannot have anything that is physical until it has a process of thinking or a blueprint or something in the spirit, all right, that plans for whatever is to come in the physical. All right, there's a plan, all right, which is actually the spiritual realm, all right, that causes everything that is physical to manifest itself. And so what Moses does in his writings, he always gives us the conversation first, all right, which is actually the blueprint, all right, and then he turns around and he shares with us what actually happens in the manifestation. And so when you look at this now, we're in 34, because 34 is the manifestation of actually 33. And so Moses, and the Bible says, and the Lord said unto Moses, Hew thee two tablets of stone like unto the first, and I will write upon these tablets the words that were in the first tablets, which thou breakest. And he and be ready in the morning, and come up in the morning unto Mount Sinai, and present thyself to there to me in the top of the mountain. And no man shall come up with thee, neither shall any man be seen throughout all of the mount, neither let the flock nor herd feed before the mount. And he hewed two tablets of stone like unto the first. And Moses rose up early in the morning and went up unto Mount Sinai, and the Lord had commanded him as the Lord had commanded him, and he took in his hand the two tablets of stone. And the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there, and proclaimed the name of the Lord. And the Lord passed by before him and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and grateful, gracious, long-suffering, and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving the iniquities and transgressions and sins, and that will be no means clear, that by means no means clear the guilty, visiting iniquities of the father upon the children, upon the children's children, and upon the third to the fourth generation. And Moses made haste, and he bowed his head toward the earth and worshiped. And he said, if now I have found grace in thy sight, O Lord, let my Lord, I pray thee, go among us, for it is a stiff-necked people, and pardon our iniquities and our sins, and take us for thy inheritance. And that's the verses 1 through 9. And so the first thing I think it's important for us to understand is that Moses is in conversation now, because God is telling him, I need you to come up in the morning, all right? I need you to hew out two stones, all right? So that when you come up, I'll be able to restore to you, all right, what you broke at the bottom of the mountain. All right, and I think we need to pause to first of all recognize what God does for Moses, he does for us all the time. And we ought to be always grateful for what God does, because there is such thing as a difference between a second chance and another chance. because a second chance simply means only God gives you twice. Two chances, and you know how you 1, 2, 3 you strike out, but God does not just give us a second chance. He gives to us another chance. I mean, all of the times that Moses allowed his anger to do things that took him beyond the restrictions of life and the restrictions of God. Yet God kept giving him another chance. When Moses came down from the mountain and he allowed his anger to throw the Ten Commandments at the foot of the mountain, all right, Moses' anger got the best of him because of what Israel was doing. And so at the end of the day, how many times have God just kept giving to us another chance? Because the second chance, we messed up a long time ago. But I think we ought to be grateful because God keeps giving us another chance, because another chance allows us to get it right, all right? And I think we ought to always be grateful that when the Lord wakes us up in the morning, we ought to know that God is trying to give us another chance. And so here it is again that God gives Moses another chance, because after Moses broke the first tablets, he says, now I want you to hew out your own tablets, but I want you to bring them up. Because what I'm going to do is I'm going to restore what you destroyed, all right? And you got to see, y'all, that these tablets are powerful presentations, because first of all, these tablets are representative of the presence of God, because God on the first tablet wrote it in it with his fingers. But Moses destroyed that, all right? Then he turned around and he put them in Moses' hands, which actually gave Moses power and purpose, because Moses was the only one that knew what was written on the Ten Commandments. He was the only one that knew that was written on the tablets. He was the only one that knew it. He was the only one that saw it, which simply means that Israel was still ignorant of what God had said, which gave Moses purpose, all right? Because at the end of the day, Moses had to live long enough to teach them what God said on these tablets. You follow what I'm saying? And so you got to see the power of it, because Moses actually threw his purpose down to the ground and destroyed his purpose simply because he allowed his anger to get the best of him. And how many times have we destroyed the very purpose of what God is trying to help us do and help us be because we allow our anger to get the best of us? And so I'm hoping and praying that you hear me today, that you got to get some control over your anger, because it will literally cause you to get things destroyed. All right? And so Moses now has to go hew out two tablets to take up to before the Lord. And God says, be ready in the morning and come up in the morning unto Mount Sinai and present thyself at the top of the mountain. And he said, don't let no man come with you. Don't let no herds or flock be feeding by the mountain, because that's going to be their death. All right? And he says, I want you to do that. All right? And the Bible says, and Moses arose early in the morning and went up unto Mount Sinai, and the Lord had as the Lord had commanded him, and he took in his hand the two tablets. All right? So now what you get now is not, you don't get the conversation now, you get the actuality of what's happening. Moses go up with the two tablets, and the Bible says when he gets up there, the presence of the Lord descends. All right, in verse 5, and it stood by him, all right? It stood with him, all right? And when he stood with him, God starts to perform what he told Moses he would perform, all right? And so now God starts proclaiming the name of the Lord, all right? And in this passage, you got capital letters, Lord, all right? And the reason they do that, because they don't want people to use the name of God in vain. And so instead of using the original name, all right, in the Hebrew translation, they just use the word Lord, all right? The word translate Yahweh, the self-existing one, that is his name. Lord is what they write in the Bible, all right, so that we know who he is, all right, without abusing and using his name, all right? And so you find out he declares, and the Lord passes by before him and proclaim the Lord God, all right? It's Jehovah, Jehovah God, all right? And then he begins to show you in this presentation what his goodness was. Because he said in verse 33, in chapter 33, that I'm going to pass by you and show you my goodness. And so in 34, he literally tells you what his goodness is. And so first of all, he says, merciful and gracious, all right, is the first two elements of his goodness, all right? You have to understand the difference between mercy and grace. Mercy, all right, is the Old Testament. Grace is the New Testament, all right? And so when you start talking about mercy, mercy says that you're guilty, but I'm going to pardon your guilt. I'm going to allow you to go free, even though I know you're guilty, all right? So in mercy, you get what you don't deserve. You deserve death, all right, but you don't get it, all right? But then when you deal with grace, all right, grace is, getting what you don't deserve, all right? And so God gives to you and extends to you his grace, all right? And none of us really deserves his grace, all right? And so what you see is a glimpse of the New and the Old Testament, because that's his goodness. He shows his goodness. He's willing to forgive. He's willing to be merciful. He's willing to be gracious, all right? And so we have to understand that anytime we experience the mercy and the grace of God, we ought to all be thankful. Long-suffering, all right? That's the second expression of his goodness, because God suffers long with us. I mean, when you look at all that he had to suffer with Israel and their unfaithfulness and their lack of faith and their anger and their complaining, I mean, from the moment that he sent Moses in there to get them, all they had for God was complaints, was unbelief, you know, anger, frightened, you know, I'm sending somebody in there to bless you and to rescue you. All you got is headache for them. You follow what I'm saying? And so God has been long-suffering, all right, with Israel and with us. Because when you even think about your personal life, all right, you got to know that God has been long-suffering, because we have done some stuff that has been outside of the boundaries of God, and yet God has showed us his mercy and his grace, all right? And we've got to be able to give God praise for his long-suffering, all right? I'm trying to hurry on, but it just seems like time ain't going to allow me. He says, I'm long-suffering. He says, I'm abundant in goodness and truth. All right. And that word abundance, I don't have to explain that to you. But he says, I'm abundant in goodness and in truth. All right. And I thank God for goodness. But what I thank God more for is for the truth. Because if you really watch how truth works, truth sets you free from everything that you was told that was a lie. All right. Because when you start looking at the truth, it starts helping you to see a different perspective of your life and your world. And what that does, it unlocks all of the goodness that God has displayed in your life, because you can literally experience the goodness of God, and because of your mentality, you won't even know that you experienced the goodness of God, because you have become so negative in your thinking, you'll look at a blessing and call it a curse. You follow what I'm saying? And so truth, what truth does is that truth unlocks, watch this, the blindness of your mind. Truth unlocks your mind in such a way that when you start looking at things, you see life from a different perspective. You see a car wreck, all right? And you say, oh my God, my car is tore up. But the truth of it is, you ought to be blessing God because you walked away from the doggone car. Because at the end of the day, we have become so kernel-minded, we're so focused on the car that we didn't even pay no attention to the fact that we walked away from the doggone car without a scratch. Test your neighbor and say, I can get another car, but I can't even get another life, all right? And so when you start looking at truth, truth helps you to see things in a different perspective. Truth helps you start celebrating what nobody else celebrates. Truth allows you to see what nobody else sees. And so at the end of the day, you got to praise God for not only just his goodness, but tell somebody, say, but his truth is what's going to help you see every good thing he performed in your life. All right? And I'm hoping I can get people to read the Bible, because that's the truth. Because that's when the Bible talks about, and the truth shall set you free. Well, that's part of that statement, because at the end of the day, you got to understand that we have declared things in life to be bad when it's actually working for our good. You see what I'm saying? Because of the way we think, because of the way we've been processing. All right? For some of us, not having money is a good thing. All right? Because if we had it, we probably go kill our dumb self with it, because we don't know what to do with it yet. God is a good God all the time, because God does not put in our hands, I can't tell you what God don't do, but I'm just saying, when I look at scriptures and I see examples, God always does what's best for us. And seems like God doesn't put things in our hands until we're ready to handle it. All right? And so I thank God for it, because at the end that he allows us, all right, to make our mistakes, because he understands that's how maturity happens. But thank God he don't ever let go of my hand, because if he did, I killed myself with my own foolishness. All right? But so watch this. It goes on and says, keeping mercy for thousands. Because God has issued, watch this, mercy to a lot of us. All right? And that's why he just uses the word thousands, because his abundance is a number of an abundance. All right? But watch this, y'all. He says, I've given my mercy to a lot of y'all. All right? Forgiving iniquities, I forgave a lot of y'all. Transgressions and sins, I forgave a lot of y'all's transgression and sin. I'm one of them. I bless God for it. And that will not in no means clear the guilty. All right? Because those who have not admitted their guilt, those of whom not have surrendered and come to Christ to get forgiveness for their guilt, they're going to have to answer for the very guilt that they hold on to, and that they did not receive forgiveness from the cross. And so they got to deal with that, and God got to deal with them. All right? But I want you to pay attention to what he says, because it's interesting. He says, visiting the iniquities of the father upon the children and upon the children's children and upon the third and the fourth generation. All right? And so it looked like God says, I'm going to cause your children to pay for your sins. And you got to understand that God ain't that kind of God. But what he wants to submit then is that what we call generational curses. All right? And so you got to understand, generational curses happens when your child is locked in an atmosphere, all right, where he has no other choice, all right, where he has no other options, where he has no, where he, there are people in Detroit that ain't been outside of 8 Mile, all right, and so my question, my thing is, because you've been locked in a certain area, all right, it seems that you've been locked in a situation where you have no other options. All right? But if you only went past 8 Mile and seen what all other options you have, then it makes your life different. All right? And so the point I'm trying to get to you is that when children are growing up in an atmosphere where they have no positive role models, then all they can walk away with is negativity. All right? And so at the end of the day, your sins, all right, passes down to your kids' children, to your kids' sins, because at the end of the day, kids don't do what you tell them. They do what you show them. All right? And so the generational curse has everything to do with our behavior passed down to our children, because our children learn to be human beings, or to act and to function in this world by watching us as their parents. And so that passing down of generational curses, you know, I saw my mama had 8 kids, and so that's what she grows up and thinks, that it's okay to do that, all right? And so at the end of the day, she has 8 kids, 9 kids, you know what I'm saying? Because that's what she's seen her mama do, all right? And so you can't get mad at them. You just got to show them better. You got to teach them better, all right? And so when you start talking about he's going to visit the iniquity of the children on the children, it's because the children start having children, all right? In this generation now, the grandmamas are now 34, all right? The grandmamas are now 30 and 40, all right? And so that's still a child, you know what I'm saying? We normally wouldn't have babies until we at least 35, 40. But, but now the kids are having them at 12 and 14 and 16. I'm just saying, generations, children are having children, all right? And those same bad behavior and habits that the children had, they pass down to their children. You understand what I'm saying? And they ain't fully developed either. You see what I'm saying? Because they never got a chance to learn and mature with life before they brought somebody else into the life. And what they actually did was pass down their bad habits to the very children that they were trying to raise. All right? And so that's what's actually happening in this life. And I think we need to be very careful that when we have children, that we do not allow our children and our children's children to see us be ugly. All right? Because I guarantee you, if you do, you're going to be the very example of what they're going to become. All right? And so my mother, which I praise God for her today, is that my mama never let me see her get mad. All right? She might have got mad. Now, I seen her with my brothers and sisters, because she was trying to tell me this was going to happen to you if you get out of line too. But my mama was the kind of lady that when she had issues in her marriage, and my brothers and sisters will attest, is the fact that she was trying to keep them out of it, all right? And even when I was growing up, my mama didn't allow me to see that kind of stuff because my mama had some kind of insight of wisdom that God gave to her that we as children shouldn't be exposed to that kind of stuff, all right? I never knew when my mama was in trouble. I never knew when my mama needed to pay the rent. I never knew when my mama was struggling. I never knew it because she didn't expose us to that stuff. She allowed us to be children. She allowed us to be kids, all right? And she says, look, anytime I got company, you don't come in here, all right? Because this is grown folks talk. Now, you need to get yourself out of here or go in your room, all right? Because you don't sit around listening to grown folks talk. You understand? I remember because, my mama didn't play. I love her for it. I thank God. But I think about what happens in the generations in which we live. We sit around and let our kids listen to our conversation, and we wonder why they're stressing out and trying to commit suicide. Because you've allowed your responsibility to spill over into your child's life, and your child is trying to figure out how to help you figure out how to help you in some kind of way because they figure that it's their fault, all right? And so at the end of the day, my mama didn't play it. I'm glad she didn't play it because my little life as a child, I couldn't find nothing wrong with it, all right? Because my mama never exposed me to it. I was just a happy as a child in the project. All right? And I'm just grateful to God for what she did. And so at the end of the day, I'm hoping you understand what I'm trying to say and allow the wisdom of God to help you to not allow your kids to see you and your husband fight or disagree or whatever, because at the end of the day, it's going to hurt them. You're going to pass your bad habits down to them. A woman, watch this, that sees a man or a child that sees a man beats his mother, that child begins to think that that's what love is. That is not what love is, all right? And we can't allow, all right, that kind of stuff to be displayed amongst our kids because everything we do, we're teaching our children. Amen? God bless you and keep you. If you want to give your life to the Lord today, you can inbox us your name, phone number, and we'll get back with you as soon as possible. And don't forget, every day at 1 o'clock, we're praying. Pray, 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 pray. Pray for our country. Pray for our president. Pray for Trump. All of us, we love him, all right? And we want to just pray that God would touch his heart. Amen. Because even in all that he's done, all right, we still got to love him and we still got to pray for him. Amen. And so at the end of the day, I want us to see that we got to move forward. And pray. Family that what? Prays together, stays together. Amen. God bless you and keep you. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you so much for your graciousness and your mercy that you've extended to us in so many different ways. And God, we never take it lightly of the grace that you share with us. And we pray that we will begin to extend that love and grace to the very people that crosses us, that do things to us and do bad things to us. And do things that are just out of order. And so, God, I pray that you teach us to be just like you. Help us to share that grace and mercy with those who don't even deserve it. But we give it because we are children of the Most High God. Cover us with your blood, and we'll be careful to give you praise, glory, and honor. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and thank God.